Affairs Symposium. It's about 2 hours.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to see you, and thank you for coming. This is 50 years from 1963, and a basic question still troubles many Americans. Very simply, why were we in Vietnam? The chronology of that year leads to a number of questions that will serve as an introduction. And I will run through this chronology. It's a little tedious, but I think you'll find it interesting. In January 1963, there were approximately 11,000 U.S. military advisors in South Vietnam, 10,000 men and women in uniform, more than in January of 1961. In December of 1962, Senator Mike Mansfield, back from South Vietnam, gave President Kennedy a very pessimistic overview and recommended an early exit from Southeast Asia. JFK was disturbed by his conversation with his old friend and supporter of Ngo Dinh Diem. The Mansfield report was published in February and greatly alarmed President Diem and his brother Ngo Dinh Nu. In January, a State Department team led by Roger Hilsman and Michael Forrestal concluded that the U.S. should not leave South Vietnam. Political and military success would come in the longer term. January 2nd, 35 miles southwest of Saigon at Ap Bac, about 400 NLF Viet Cong forces stood their ground against 1,500 ARVN South Vietnamese troops. Five helicopters were destroyed and nine others seriously damaged, creating a bitter controversy. Ap Bac became a revisionist issue recounted in two books that are now famous, A Bright Shining Lie by Neil Sheehan and Triumph Forsaken by Mark Moyar. Question, was Ap Bac an ARVN disaster or at best a draw? And what were the consequences? In March, the Secretary General of the VWP, the Workers' Party of Vietnam, Lê Duan, sided with the People's Republic of China opposing the USSR in the Sino-Soviet split, Ho Chi Minh having apparently lost much of his influence. Was Lê Duan in control in Hanoi at this time? And what feedback did American intelligence have on the power shift in North Vietnam? In April 22nd, the CIA warned the White House of Ngo Dinh Nu's increasingly anti-American positions. In 1961, Kennedy had approved a covert action against North Vietnam under CIA supervision. Following Maxwell Taylor's recommendations, Operation Switchback, in the summer of 1963, Operational Plan 24A was shifted to the Pentagon. Question, what was the size and effectiveness of covert operations into North Vietnam in 1963? On May 8th, South Vietnamese police and civil guards killed a number of Buddhist protesters in Hue, during a religious demonstration. The dispute escalated, setting the stage for major unrest against Diem. On May 12th, the Washington Post published statements by Ngo Dinh Nu suggesting that half of the American advisors, some 6,000 men, should leave South Vietnam. Reports of contacts between Nu and the North Vietnamese were used in part to justify a military coup. Question, how serious were those contacts? Is there North Vietnamese corroboration? And are there documents on the issue? On June 12th, the first Buddhist monk set himself on fire in downtown Saigon. The image created massive revulsion worldwide. Madame Nu made abrasive statements to the press. On June 27th, JFK announced the appointment of Henry Cabot Lodge as ambassador to South Vietnam. and secret conversations were held by CIA officer Lou Conin with opposition military leaders about the overthrow of Diem and his brother. On August 5th, a second Buddhist monk committed suicide by fire, and Diem signed a martial law decree and special forces ransacked Buddhist pagodas, arresting over 1,400 monks. Question: was the Buddhist crisis a legitimate protest against the Catholic Diem regime, or was it staged by communist sympathizers? On August 24th, a State Department cable drafted by Roger Hilsman and approved by the president informed Ambassador Cabot Lodge that the U.S. would not oppose a coup to remove Diem and Nu. General Minh aborted coup preparations on August 31st because of a lack of support. On August 29th, French President Charles de Gaulle issued a statement calling for the withdrawal of all foreign troops and the reunification of Vietnam as a united neutral country based on the 1954 Geneva Accords. The Kennedy administration did not follow up and discouraged any discussion with the French. Question: why were both JFK and LBJ adamant about keeping Vietnam as an exclusively American show? Wouldn't the French proposal have provided an acceptable exit for the United States? On September 2nd, Kennedy was interviewed by Walter Cronkite and hinted that Diem should fire his brother, Nu. He also stated, "I don't agree with those who say we should withdraw." The White House then announced plans to withdraw 1,000 U.S. troops from Vietnam by the end of the year. On September 10th, General Victor Krulak and diplomat Joseph Mendenhall offered JFK contradictory reports after a joint mission to South Vietnam. The military were satisfied and the diplomats were pessimistic. On September 30, a mission by Robert McNamara and General Maxwell Taylor concluded that the war was at a stalemate and cautioned against backing a coup. Question: was the Pentagon advice swept aside? On October 5th, McGeorge Bundy drafted National Security Action Memo 263, announcing the expected withdrawal of the bulk of U.S. forces by 1965. Question: did this also imply rotating in larger numbers of U.S. troops before they were to be withdrawn? Finally, CIA's Lou Conin and General Big Minh made final preparations for a coup. On November 1st, the palace in Saigon was stormed. Diem and Nu were murdered. The U.S. recognized the military junta on November 8. On November 22nd, JFK was assassinated. On November 26, President Johnson signed off on National Security Action Memo 273, approving covert action against North Vietnam. In December 1963, there were approximately 16,300 military advisors in South Vietnam. That's my introduction. And now I would like to introduce our first speaker, Mr. John Prados, who is the author of many books and has spoken to us many times. And his latest book, Vietnam, History of an Unwinnable War, is a masterpiece of research and history. Please welcome Mr. John Prados.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be back here. I have to say, one small correction to add, my latest book is The Family Jewels, the CIA Secrecy and Presidential Power. But Vietnam Unwinnable War is about exactly our subject tonight. And I am going to touch on some of its aspects briefly, but what I would like to do more than that is to help set the stage for this conversation that we're going to have over the next 2 days. I'm going to talk about what I see as some of the key issues and developments of 1963, and I think that you will hear a lot more about each one of them from our other speakers tonight. Ed Miller briefly, I'm sorry. Op Bach was mentioned at the outset of Mr. Miller's remarks. And Op Bach was primordial in the sense of Vietnam as a war, because it was, in a way, a pitched battle, although a small one, but between generated forces on both sides, and one in which the National Liberation Front forces stood their ground against the South Vietnamese Army, even with its helicopters and its armored personnel carriers and its superior firepower. The question of what that meant in terms of the military balance is one of the key issues in 1963. I argue in Unwinnable War, The History of an Unwinnable War, that the Vietnam conflict was characterized by what I call an information gap. That is, that players, and even on many sides of this conflict, did not have a close understanding or even know what the proper indices were to follow developments in the war. And Op Bach is a case of this. A second aspect, which is very important in 1963, and in particular for identifying whether the military balance was shifting, had shifted, had not shifted, was the question of the Strategic Hamlet Program. The evolution of the Strategic Hamlet Program, which had started about a year earlier, was a key difference, actually, between the United States and South Vietnam, and it was perceived in Hanoi as a threat. The North Vietnamese were very concerned that this might be a tactic and a technique that might work against them. The Diem government in Saigon, in my opinion, was overly confident about their work on the Strategic Hamlet Program, and confident enough to want to sort of close out the American contribution on Strategic Hamlets. And then the Americans were looking at the Strategic Hamlets and at first thinking that they were wildly successful, and then in growing doubt about their success. This concatenation is symptomatic of this kind of information gap. You march forward into the summer of 1963 in Washington, you have American intelligence authorities arguing about, is Vietnam a successful war? Are we winning? Are we not winning? And there was a dispute, in fact, between the Pentagon and State Department intelligence and between the CIA and the Pentagon about the status of the war in South Vietnam. Washington ultimately overrode the objections of its own intelligence people to take a more optimistic view of what was going on in South Vietnam than a lot of our intelligence experts felt was warranted. This raises one of the contradictions of 1963, because here you have senior officials in Washington arguing that we should discount intelligence that shows that we're not winning the war. But on the other hand, those same senior officials looking at the American relationship with the South Vietnamese government are saying that the Diem government is not prosecuting the war to its fullest extent, and therefore there need to be change. The South Vietnamese government needs to make reforms. In particular, President Diem needs to stop the nepotism and get rid of family members of his who are entrenched in key positions in the government. And that brings us to a third of the key issues, which is the whole question of the coup. There is a lot to be said about the coup in South Vietnam, and I think a lot of this is going to be said here at this conference. But just to throw this out, and as a further illustration of this question of what was happening in the war and who was up and who was down, South Vietnamese generals came to the CIA, approached the Americans first, and said, you know, will you support us if we mount a coup to overthrow Ngo Dinh Diem? The question of Vietnamese agency in all of this is critical. This was not an American fomented project in the sense that, say, the Bay of Pigs was, or the CIA's operation in Guatemala in 1954. This was a suggestion made by South Vietnamese officers, and they themselves perceived that they were not succeeding in the war with the South Vietnamese government as it then existed. So here's another factor, one of these issues. The South Vietnamese ranged on various sides of the question of how they are doing in the war. Then there is the question of North Vietnam. And Mr. Miller raised that briefly. Was Le Duan in control? What were the North Vietnamese interests, relations, perceptions of the conflict in South Vietnam, of the strategic hamlets, of opportunity versus threat in South Vietnam? The year 1963 ends with a North Vietnamese political conference that adopts a resolution that basically sets a policy of prosecuting the war in South Vietnam at a new higher level. And the questions of what led to that and who is behind that are also central to the further history of the Vietnam War. Now, before I sit down, I want to say a couple of things about the coup itself in terms of American policy. Here is a situation where the United States wasn't starting with its own project. It was free to accept or reject participating in this enterprise. More than that, the United States was in a situation where there were grounds for going either way. John F. Kennedy, the president at that time, had come just off of the Cuban Missile Crisis less than a year earlier, in which he had triumphed in a major nuclear crisis with the Soviet Union. And he had a strong political position, good political capital that he could engage on either side of this question. He also had a wide margin, a wide range of political maneuver that he could go into because the United States public in 1963, unlike in 1967 or 1970 or 1972, had not taken positions on the Vietnam War. There wasn't a large opposition to the American war in Vietnam, and if anything, in 1963, there were more interest groups favoring American action in South Vietnam than opposing it. I did not mention, and I should have, one key aspect of the year, and that was the Buddhist crisis, because that became catalyst for much of the rest that happened. And it's important to note that in terms of the Buddhist crisis, the American press now reported very consistently and in considerable depth on what was going on in South Vietnam around the Buddhist crisis. And I submit to you, it's a measure of how little American political pundits and the American public were interested in Vietnam at that time that despite all of this discussion in the press, there wasn't a greater public outcry in the United States in the summer of 1963 about what was going on in South Vietnam. So essentially what you had was the Kennedy administration with freedom of action, a South Vietnamese military that had decided to act, wavering and uncertain military situation, and a North Vietnam that was poised to take greater action. My colleagues are now going to elaborate on many different aspects of these themes. Thank you very much.
My pleasure to introduce Jessica Chapman. She has researched Vietnam decolonization in the Cold War. She is the author of Cauldron of Resistance in Ngo Dinh Diem, the United States, and 1950s South Vietnam. Thank you for coming, Jessica.
Thank you very much for hosting this event. I'm going to throw a little wrench in the chronological works tonight, I think, by talking mainly about events that occurred prior to 1963. My contestation in my book is that you can really only understand the events of 1963 in the context of the longer-term political events that sort of led to American involvement in the form that it took and led to American support of Ngo Dinh Diem and the policies that he pursued. I find it fitting that the opening question was, why were we in Vietnam? 1963 is an incredibly critical year in explaining why it was that we escalated the war in Vietnam in the way that we did. But it's not the answer to the question of why we were in Vietnam. That's a much larger question that covers a much bigger span of time. I think we need to look back earlier than 1963 to understand the events of that year. And in fact, John Prados mentioned the information gap that sort of dogged understandings on all sides of what was happening militarily in 1963 and throughout the war. And I think that's really pertinent to what I'm going to talk about today, because that information gap was very much present in Vietnamese and American understandings of each other and misapprehensions of each other from the very beginning of American involvement in Vietnam. In my book, I explore the chaotic competition for post-colonial political control that unfolded in southern Vietnam between the Second World War and the formation of the communist-backed National Liberation Front in 1960. And I do that specifically by placing it in the context of southern Vietnam's unique regional frontier character, which I refer to in the book as the Wild South, which is meant to kind of parallel the Wild West in the United States. And evoke images of that type of frontier environment. So today I want to explain that frontier character very briefly, and then today I'm going to talk about how it factored into Ngo Dinh Diem's appointment as prime minister. So this says, or it may say, part one of this talk. I'm going to continue with these comments tomorrow and actually bring us up to 1963, but my comments today are mainly going to focus on Ngo Dinh Diem's appointment as prime minister and the role that the United States played in that and the way that it interacted with this unique southern character that I identify in my work. Instability had really been a hallmark of southern Vietnamese society for generations, and this was true even prior to its colonization by the French. The Mekong Delta was marked by such geographic, economic, social, ethnic, and cultural heterodoxies that one scholar has deemed it the least coherent territory in the world. So all of these factors combined to make the region notoriously difficult to govern, and that was true first for the French, then for the Viet Minh, and eventually for Ngo Dinh Diem and his American backers. This context helps explain why, between the 1920s and 1940s, while nationalists in northern and central Vietnam developed Western-influenced countrywide anti-colonial organizations like Ho Chi Minh's Indochinese Communist Party, or the ICP, and the Vietnamese Nationalist Party, millenarian groups took root as the South's most powerful agents of anti-colonialism. In a complex and often violent anti-colonial politics of Vietnam's Wild South, where much of the French and American wars would play out, the Hua Hao and Cao Dai, two politico-religious organizations, often referred to as sects, but I prefer the term politico-religious organizations because it doesn't have the same derogatory connotations and it's actually a more apt descriptor of who they were, especially when you consider that they were bunched together with the Binh Xuyen Crime Syndicate, which was an organization with extensive and sometimes very surprising connections to nationalist politics, but nonetheless was not a sect in the sense that we normally use that term. So these three groups would be key actors in southern Vietnam's political sphere. By the end of the Second World War, these three organizations responded to the dislocations that had been caused by French rule and by Japan's occupation by balkanizing into armed administrative units. The ICP and other countrywide anti-colonial organizations were in fact incredibly weak in the South following a failed insurrection in 1940, which encouraged the radicalization of these three organizations and facilitated the rapid expansion of their power in southern Vietnam. During the war, the Japanese occupation further inspired them to become more overtly nationalistic and anti-French, and with Japanese support, both the Cao Dai and the Hua Hao began to militarize. All three organizations worked throughout the early 1940s to position themselves to play a major role in post-colonial Vietnamese politics at the end of the war. After the August Revolution, so Ho Chi Minh and the Viet Minh's Revolution, following Japan's surrender in 1945, Viet Minh generals made an effort to subsume southern Vietnam's disparate nationalist forces into their revolutionary front. So they tried to bring Cao Dai, Hua Hao, and Binh Xuyen military leaders into the Viet Minh front so they could be a united revolutionary force. But they often did that by force and intimidation in ways that quickly alienated these southern nationalist leaders. And that conflict drove all three of the politico-religious organizations into alliances of convenience with the French, who paid them handsomely to defend their regional strongholds across South Vietnam against Viet Minh forces. Wartime French subsidies enabled these organizations to grow even stronger and enabled them to entrench in their autonomous zones throughout the course of the war. So by the end of the war, they occupied and controlled approximately one-third of the territory and population of southern Vietnam in autonomous regions. So in light of this southern Vietnamese political context that I've fleshed out very quickly, I want to discuss Diem's 1954 appointment as prime minister. Historical debates surrounding South Vietnam's chief of state are Bao Dai's decision, former emperor, chief of state of the state of Vietnam's decision to appoint Ngo Dinh Diem, usually center on the extent to which the United States was behind the selection. Some argue that the CIA basically ordered Bao Dai to name Diem prime minister. Others argue that Diem and his brother Ngo Dinh Diu maneuvered Diem into power by working over the long term to establish his nationalist credentials within the southern Vietnamese political sphere, and that American preferences factored in hardly at all. I see the answer to this question as falling somewhere between these two poles. Bao Dai's decision to appoint Ngo Dinh Diem prime minister of southern Vietnam's first post-war government was heavily influenced by the United States. Although Bao Dai made his selection autonomously, he wasn't forced into anything, he fundamentally recognized that the southern government would need support from Washington in order to survive, and appears to have chosen Diem largely in response to pressure from the State Department and the CIA. By the end of the war, Niu had maneuvered himself, and by extension his brother, into a leading position within southern Vietnam's non-communist political sphere. Equally, if not more important, though, were the activities Diem undertook in the preceding years to ingratiate himself with powerful religious and political leaders in the United States. And this gave him a distinct advantage over other nationalist figures, like Cao Dai Pope Pham Kong Thach, who had also earned a prominent position in South Vietnamese nationalist circles. But the key was, although he had earned that prominent position in the South Vietnamese political context, he failed to persuade the United States of his capacity to lead. Beginning in 1973, just about 1 year before the French surrendered at Dien Bien Phu, a fierce competition erupted among political figures in Saigon. This was precipitated by the French decision to devalue the piastre, which sort of signaled an impending end to the war. And so, anticipating this end to the French war, Southern Vietnam's most prominent non-communist nationalists began to struggle to position themselves to claim power in the impending post-war government. Hua Hao, Cao Dai, and Binh Xuân figures played incredibly central roles in this process, and Pham Kham Thach emerged as a leader essentially on par with Ngo Dinh Diem. American officials, however, found calls from Pham for radical concessions from the French to hasten Vietnamese independence to be frustrating, to say the least. Ambassador Donald Heath accused Pham and his politico-religious allies of displaying emotional, irresponsible nationalism and concluded, "It is a matter of extraordinary difficulty to convey the degree of naivete and childlike belief that no matter what defamatory language they use, the Vietnamese will still be safeguarded from the lethal communist enemy by France and the United States." Gradually throughout this process, American embassy officials shifted from referring to Hua Hao, Cao Dai, and Binh Xuân leaders as nationalists to beginning to label them things like warlords, plotters, confessional groups, or even the junta. From those dismissive American assessments of these groups, it's by no means obvious that by early 1954, if not sooner, politico-religious leaders were making concerted efforts to align their political appeals with exactly what they understood to be Washington's Cold War objectives in Vietnam, namely an end to colonial rule and the establishment of a stable, non-communist government in the South. The French war was winding down, and it was becoming clear that the ability of any Southern nationalist to assert leadership in a post-war government would depend on American sanction. Hua Hao, Cao Dai, and Binh Xuân figures therefore sharpened their critiques of French colonialism and sought to distance themselves from the French who were paying them these subsidies. And they focused more and more on their ideological opposition to communism, as well as emphasizing their histories of violent opposition to the Viet Minh, and used that, in fact, to explain why it was that they had made this marriage of convenience with the French. It wasn't that they didn't have strong anti-colonial credentials, but they needed to do this in order to pursue the even more important goal of ensuring that the Viet Minh didn't take over the South. As Washington searched for anti-communist nationalist leadership in Vietnam that could inspire popular passion, politico-religious leaders desperately hoped that they could provide the answer. However, U.S. officials remained wedded to their conviction that Hua Hao, Cao Dai, and Binh Xuân figures were backward, irrational, corrupt, and incapable of providing effective national leadership. Of Pham, they wrote, "The Cao Daiist Pope, although fond of strutting on the podium, in reality had no political judgment. American officials called him politically naive and unpredictable, and a charlatan with no convictions, who is lured by will-of-the-wisp neutralism." By dismissing Pham and other political religious leaders in this manner, the United States wrote off the most influential power blocks and individuals in southern Vietnam, aside from the Ngo brothers, with whom they were more intimately familiar. Indeed, American officials' positive assessments of Ngo Dinh Diem contrasted sharply with their negative opinions of Pham. They lauded his unquestioned integrity, his sincerity, nationalism, and honesty. And so Bao Dai appointed Diem prime minister in hopes of simultaneously satisfying the United States and appointing somebody that had sufficient nationalist credentials within the southern Vietnamese political sphere that he could hopefully rally other non-communist southern nationalists behind the new government. At the time of his appointment, many of Diem's competitors took it upon themselves to caution American officials about what they saw as his troubling shortcomings. One warned that Diem's high moral character and personal integrity did not compensate for his almost total lack of professional competence and administrative experience, and feared that Diem's narrow sectarian approach would alienate the country's other non-communist nationalists. Others warned that he lacked popular appeal, and perhaps presciently, was too insular and unsuited to leadership. Many French officials shared these concerns and strongly cautioned Bao Dai in the United States against pursuing Diem's appointment and continued to work against Diem, trying to bring about an early end to the Diem experiment, which I'll talk more about tomorrow. But during summer of 1954, U.S. officials themselves had little more than a dim hope for Diem and South Vietnam's non-communist future. Shortly after Diem's appointment, U.S. Counsel Robert McClintock cabled to Secretary of State John Foster Dulles, Bao Dai's action in requesting that Ngo Dinh Diem form a government has totally failed to arouse the enthusiasm of the Vietnamese people, so essential if the war effort and the National Army are to get necessary support. Ambassador Douglas Dillon described Diem with the following mixed review. He impresses one as a mystic who has just emerged from a religious retreat into the cold world, which is, in fact, almost what he has done. He appears too unworldly and unsophisticated to be able to cope with the grave problems and unscrupulous people he will find in Saigon. Yet his apparent sincerity, patriotic fervor, and honesty are refreshing by comparison, and we are led to think that these qualities may outweigh his other deficiencies. The grossly unrealistic attitude to current problems in the past appears to have improved. On balance, we are favorably impressed, but only in the realization that we are prepared to accept the seemingly ridiculous prospect that this yogi-like mystic could assume the charge he is apparently about to undertake, only because the standard set by his predecessors is so low. In short, American officials had serious doubts about Diem's leadership abilities, but they embraced him as the candidate who was most likely to unify South Vietnam and prevent communism from spreading there. But the task of unifying and pacifying Southern Vietnam in the wake of the Geneva Conference that ended the French War would be a heady one for any leader, much less one with the limitations attributed to the new prime minister. Diem returned to Saigon in June of 1954 after a long absence to a site of near anarchy. He took control of a weakly defined political entity that lacked the institutions and organization required to run a centralized government. When he took power, these three politico-religious organizations collectively controlled approximately one-third of the territory and population below the 17th parallel. Within their autonomous zones, they collected taxes, elected their own officials, and maintained their own fairly strong militaries. The Binh Xuyên had a monopoly over Saigon Cholon vice industries, running prostitution rings and casinos, trading in opium, illegally imposing quote-unquote road safety taxes in the roadways in and out of Saigon. In 1953, Binh Xuyên leader purchased the Saigon Cholon police concession from Bao Dai for over $1.2 million, which enabled his forces to rove the city without even nominal oversight. A number of other destabilizing factors compounded Diem's difficulty in consolidating power over remarkably fractious South Vietnam. The National Army rested under the independent control of the Francophile general Nguyen Van Hin, who had organized an early coup attempt against the prime minister, although unsuccessfully. So the way Diem attempted to deal with this domestic political context was to impose a very draconian divide-and-conquer policy almost immediately that pitted him against these politico-religious organizations that held such prominent positions in the South. And he prevailed very quickly in ways that I'll talk more about tomorrow in defeating his domestic political opposition, oppressing and suppressing all of his opponents. But he did so at a serious cost. And he did so in a way that really framed his administration around that need to eliminate and suppress all political opposition. And I want to highlight here that it was opposition from these politico-religious organizations and their allies that I've been talking about, and not communist opposition, that posed the greatest challenge to Diem's success in the early years. The campaign against communists that largely defined Diem's government was in fact developed to combat the threat posed by these three organizations that I've been talking about, and other individual political figures who allied with them during the first 2 years of his government. and it always targeted a much broader range of political opponents than just communists. Diem was so determined to silence political threats that he forced his rival, Pham Kon Thak, to seek exile in Cambodia by late 1956. This move was intended to eliminate opposition and suppress dissent against his government, but it ultimately backfired to generate discontent amongst Cao Dai followers. And you can see here, this is the sort of state of affairs in 1957. Ngo Dinh Diem is on tour in the United States, shaking hands with Eisenhower, at the point in American history where he is viewed as America's miracle man in Vietnam for having managed to consolidate his power in the amazing way that he did by 1957. However, back in Vietnam, you see Cao Dai followers protesting the exile of Pham Kon Thak in ways that would fuel opposition within that community of non-communist nationalists to Ngo Dinh Diem's government, beginning in those early years in ways that would ramp up later and in some ways contribute to the political crises that Diem experienced in 1963. So I'm going to talk more tomorrow about how Diem dealt with his antagonists among the Cao Dai, Hua Hao, and Binh Xuan, and importantly, some of the lessons that he learned and implemented from his apparent triumph against them. And those lessons, of course, I argue, led him to pursue policies that only contributed to the political crisis that brought down his government and ended his life in 1963. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a great lecture. I'd like to introduce Edward G. Miller, who is Associate Professor of History at Dartmouth College. His latest book is Misalliance, Ngo Dinh Diem, the United States, and the Fate of South Vietnam, published this year.
I'd like also to express my thanks to Bob Miller and Bob Rowan and everyone else here at NYMAS for putting on this conference. I'm really looking forward to tonight and our discussions tomorrow. I have to begin with a warning. As you can probably tell, I've been battling a cold this week, and I believe I have the upper hand. But as a Vietnam War historian, I'm very leery of premature predictions of victory. Put differently, I don't expect to defeat this cold in the next 15 minutes, but I hope not to lose in that time.
As light at the end of the tunnel.
I'm not going to say that either. My remarks tonight are drawn from my recently published book that Bob mentioned. If we could get the first slide up here, please, you'll see the title there.
And you've got the,
I've got the clicker. Will this work?
Yeah,
no.
Well, I have to get it off.
Okay. There it is. The main objective of this book, which was published in March by Harvard University Press, is to provide a new interpretation of Ngo Dinh Diem, who, of course, was the founding leader of South Vietnam. And I also want to suggest what I think is a different way of thinking about Diem's alliance with the United States and a different explanation for the rise and fall of that alliance. I'm going to begin with a couple of images, one of which will be extremely familiar because Jessica just showed it to you. This, of course, as Jessica indicated, is a picture taken during Diem's official visit to the United States in 1957. And there are a couple of interesting things about this picture. One is that it's taken at the airport in Washington, D.C., And President Eisenhower is at the airport. He actually came out to the airport to greet Diem when he arrived. This is a very rare honor to be bestowed on a foreign leader on a visit to the United States. During this visit, Diem also addressed a joint session of the U.S. Congress. He received several honorary degrees from multiple U.S. universities. He even got a ticker tape parade down Broadway. I mean, it's kind of hard to imagine any foreign leader receiving that kind of honor today, maybe somebody like Nelson Mandela. This suggests that Diem was not just another foreign leader or just another foreign ally. He was really seen as a hero in 1957. However, if you fast forward to 1963, there are very different pictures coming out of South Vietnam. I'm sure all of you have seen this very famous photograph. This was taken, of course, during the major political crisis known as the Buddhist crisis in the spring and summer of 1963. This involved protests, as John indicated, led by Buddhist monks against the Diem government. This picture, taken by the journalist Malcolm Brown, was the most famous act of protest, the monk Thich Quang Duc immolating himself. Diem eventually crushed these protests by force in August of 1963. But of course, that didn't end the political crisis in South Vietnam. And 2 months later, as John indicated, South Vietnamese generals launched a coup. Diem and his brother Ngo Dinh Nhu were captured and executed. The evidence shows very clearly that the U.S. government, the Kennedy administration, encouraged the generals to carry out the coup. The U.S. did not sanction the assassinations. I think that's quite clear from the evidence, but the U.S. did endorse the coup. So in contemporary parlance, this is a case of the United States switching from this policy of very strong support for Diem to a policy of regime change. Now, of course, this is certainly not a unique case in the history of U.S. foreign relations, or even in the history of the Cold War. There's plenty of examples of the U.S. attempting to oust foreign leaders with whom it had previously supported with varying degrees of success. However, I do think that the case of Diem and the rise and fall of this relationship does have some distinctive features which makes it worthy of closer study. Perhaps the most obvious is just that Diem's death is clearly a major event in the history of the Vietnam War. It leads directly to the massive escalation of the Vietnam War, escalation by both communist leaders in Hanoi and then subsequently by Lyndon Johnson and the United States. So it's a very important event on its own merits in that sense. The other reason I think it's important is because Diem was not just another U.S. ally. For a while, he was really seen, at least in some circles, as a model U.S. ally. So the extent of Diem's transformation in American eyes is quite remarkable. How does he go from being the miracle man of South Vietnam to being an obstacle that had to be removed? And so this is what my book attempts to explain. And I'm, of course, far from the first scholar to write about Diem. Jessica is also not the first scholar to write about Diem. There are many who have come before us. But I think my interpretation does differ from most of the older scholarship in a couple of key ways. One way has to do with sources. The existing scholarship, until very recently, relies mainly or exclusively on U.S. materials. I used a great many U.S. sources in my research, but I also used a lot of Vietnamese archival sources. I did research in Vietnam, including in the South Vietnamese government archives. The South Vietnamese state no longer exists, but the archives are still there, at least some portion of them are still there, and they are now accessible to researchers. So that's one thing that's different about my book. But I think an even more significant difference has to do with the way I interpret Diem and his ideas and policies. Until now, I think that most of the writings on Diem, until very recently, there's a number of us who are trying to interpret Diem in a different way. But until the last few years, I think most of the writings on Diem were frankly quite simplistic. There were a certain number of stock caricatures of Diem that keep coming up again and again in the scholarship. Some authors have portrayed him as an American puppet. They argue he was created by the United States and therefore had no agenda of his own except preserving his own power. Another very common interpretation is that Diem was a quote-unquote traditional leader, a mandarin, a pre-modern guy who somehow got stuck in the 20th century. So according to this view, Diem was atavistic and anti-modern, and therefore not really interested in things like development or nation building. He just wanted to turn back the clock. A third interpretation that's out there is much more sympathetic to Diem. This view holds that, yes, Diem was traditional. He was sort of this latter-day Confucian sage. But that was actually okay, because according to this view, what Vietnam needed was a traditional ruler, because Vietnam was a quote-unquote traditional society. My view is very different from all of these interpretations. I don't find any of these existing interpretations convincing for two reasons. First, there's not much evidence to suggest them. In the discussion, I can say more about that if you're interested. But my real beef with these interpretations is I don't think they're very historical. And what I mean by that is they really make no attempt to understand Diem in the actual historical context in which he lived his life. And this, of course, was early 20th century Vietnam. I think another problem with these interpretations is that they deny Diem's agency. In these conventional accounts, Diem really has no independent ideas of his own. He's just a creation of American power or a creature of tradition. So, what is the alternative? How do we gain a more historical understanding of Diem? Well, in my book, I try to do three things towards this larger objective. The first thing I do is I try to understand Diem in the actual historical context in which he lived. And this means connecting Diem's life and career specifically to colonialism and empire. Diem lived most of his life during the period of French colonial rule in Vietnam, and he began his political career as a functionary in the French colonial state. Now, this isn't to say that Diem was pro-French or that he was anti-nationalist. In fact, he was very nationalist. He was a strident critic of the French colonial state. But even his nationalism was heavily shaped by the colonial context in which he lived and operated. And in this regard, Diem is really no different from other members of his generation of post-colonial leaders across the Third World, people like Sukarno or Kwame Nkrumah, or even somebody like Ho Chi Minh, I would argue, is very shaped by the colonial context in which he came of age. So that's the first thing I'm trying to do, is connect Diem to colonialism and empire. The second major objective here is to try to understand Diem's ideas about development and nation building. As I said, a lot of scholars have tried to suggest that Diem was uninterested in these things. I do not. I argue in the book that Diem was a man who had a plan. He had very elaborate ideas about different aspects of nation building. He had very definite ideas about things like agrarian reform, resettlement of the rural population. This was a very important concept for Diem, and he pursued it very ardently while he was in power. The building of new communities. Diem had a lot of ideas about these things. Government reform, the creation of a republic, the Republic of Vietnam that Diem proclaimed in 1955. This was very important to him. Elections, a constitution, democracy. Diem spent a lot of time talking about all of these things. Finally, Diem's internal security policies and counterinsurgency strategies. These were also nation-building aspects for Diem. These were aspects of Diem's nation-building policies. And in the book, I examine all of these different policy areas in detail. So that's sort of the second major contribution that I see coming from the book. The last and perhaps most important contribution is to explain why, in the long run, this nation-building agenda of Diem's was not successful. And here I think it's important to point out that my book is neither a celebration nor a condemnation of Diem. I think most of the existing scholarship does fit into one or the other of those two categories. I don't see Diem as being either a runaway success or a total failure. I think his record was mixed. In the end, I see him having more failures than successes, but he did have some successes. Probably his most significant success had to do with what I would refer to as state building being a subset of the larger project of nation building, in expanding the administrative capacity of the South Vietnamese state, in creating a new republic, setting up new institutions, expanding and strengthening the South Vietnamese bureaucracy, establishing new laws and regulations. These were no mean achievements, and the things that Diem did in these areas were significant. However, despite these gains in the areas of state building, Diem ultimately had two big problems that I think he couldn't overcome. The first problem was that his ideas about nation building did not mesh very well with those of his American allies. This is why I argue that in the end, the alliance between the U.S. and Diem was a misalliance. It was a bad match. Their two approaches were just not very compatible. Diem was very anti-communist, and of course the Americans were fine with that, but he was also very anti-liberal. So when you look at his ideas about things like community, agrarian reform, democracy, he's using in some cases the same words that the Americans are using, but the meanings are very different, and the prescriptions and the policies that he's advocating are very different from those advocated by his American allies. So that's one big problem that Diem has, and one big cause of his his ultimate downfall. The other one was that his nation-building programs encountered a lot of resistance from his fellow South Vietnamese. Diem, as I said, did have some success in the area of state-building, but nation-building is never just about state-building. In order to be successful in nation-building, you also have to critically pursue what I refer to as identity-building, on forging ties between the people you want to govern and the institutions that you have created or are trying to strengthen. And in general, Diem was just not very good at identity building. I think this was very apparent in the countryside, where his policies produced a lot of resistance, resentment, and fear. This is especially the case as a result of his resettlement programs, things like the Agraville program rolled out in 1959, this attempt to create new rural communities, these massive sort of farming plantations in the Mekong Delta, were done with a great deal of coercion and were also shot through with corruption. So this really led to a popular backlash. And this was something that the communists exploited to great effect when they launched their insurgency against Diem in 1959 and 1960. Diem's shortcomings in the area of identity building were also apparent in his dealings with fellow Vietnamese anti-communists. On this point, I think I'm perhaps both similar and different from some of the claims that Jessica has advanced here. In the early years, I see Diem as actually winning support from some important groups of South Vietnamese anti-communists. He was relatively successful in winning support among his fellow Catholics. Army officers were a very important group for Diem during his first years in power, and he was very good initially at winning over key members of the Arvin Officer Corps. Some urban South Vietnamese nationalists, even some Buddhist groups. Diem's relations with institutional Buddhist groups in his early years in power were actually pretty good. Unfortunately for Diem, by the early 1960s, he had alienated many of these former supporters. And by 1963, of course, many of these groups are going to support or actually participate in his overthrow. That's certainly the case with the generals who lead the coup against Diem. All of those generals had formerly been Diemists. They had all formerly supported him in one way or another. And it's certainly true of the Buddhists, who, as I said earlier, had pretty good relations with him. So to sum up the basic argument of the book, nation building, I think, was a really important element in the history of the US-Diem alliance. On the one hand, the differences between American ideas about nation building and Diem's ideas created a lot of tension in the alliance. On the other hand, Diem's actual nation building policies also generated a lot of resistance within South Vietnam. And what you see in 1963 is these two aspects of the contest over nation building in South Vietnam coming together. And this is what I think leads to both the dissolution of the alliance and the overthrow of the Diem government. So that's the argument of the book in a nutshell. There's a great more material that's in the book, which I don't have time to talk about now. Because the topic of the conference is 1963, I want to just finish up with a couple of remarks about events that took place in 1963 and talk specifically about the Buddhist crisis. And I'll have more to say on this and some other 1963-related things tomorrow. The Buddhist crisis, as John indicated, began in May of 1963. It was precipitated by the emergence of an anti-Diem protest movement led by Buddhist monks. I did a lot of research on the Buddhist movement and on Diem's response to the crisis, which is presented in the book in the last couple of chapters. And there's a couple of key findings that I argue for, which I think are very different from the conventional wisdom on the subject. The first of these is that the Buddhist crisis was not just a religious conflict. The conventional view was that the 1963 crisis was a straightforward case of religious discrimination or even persecution. During the crisis, the Buddhists accused Diem of this, of trying to suppress their religion. There were definitely officials in the Diem government, including members of Diem's own family, who were guilty of this. Some of Diem's brothers in particular, as I'll note in a moment. However, the roots of the crisis went much deeper than a mere response to religious discrimination. The Buddhist movement in 1963 is not an isolated event in the history of Vietnamese Buddhism. It's actually an episode in a much larger, longer-running phenomenon known as the Vietnamese Buddhist Revival. This is something that began decades earlier in the 1910s and 1920s, when some Buddhists felt that Vietnamese Buddhism had become too distant from the lives of ordinary Vietnamese lay people. And so you have this reform movement in Vietnamese Buddhism where monks and nuns are arguing they need to get out of the pagodas, get involved in the affairs of the world. And from the beginning, this revival had both religious and political goals. On the one hand, there was this emphasis on reviving Buddhism through social activism. So you see monks becoming much more involved in lay education and social work. On the other hand, the Buddhist revival was very explicitly nationalist. And in particular, Buddhists began to talk about national Buddhism. Their argument was that Vietnam was a quote-unquote Buddhist nation. And so therefore, Vietnam, in order to survive and thrive in the modern world, had to cultivate its Buddhist traditions. This nationalism had very clear political implications. All of the leaders of the 1963 protests against Diem are supporters and participants in this Vietnamese Buddhist revival. Now, during Diem's first years in power, as I said, he actually had pretty good relations with these Buddhist leaders, with these Buddhist nationalists. He was cultivating them. He was actually providing money for them to build new pagodas, to form new organizations. However, after 1960, some Buddhists become more skeptical of Diem, and they begin to see his nation-building policies as hostile to their Buddhist reform agenda. So that, I think, is one very important aspect of the 1963 crisis that's been overlooked. The other very important aspect that I'll just briefly mention here has to do with conflicts within Diem's family, among the members of the Ngo family, and specifically among his brothers. The Buddhists were initially upset in 1963, not by Diem, but by certain actions taken by his older brother, Ngo Dinh Thoc. Ngo Dinh Thoc, as many of you know, was the archbishop of the city of Hue, which is one of the larger cities in central Vietnam. And it's significant that the Buddhist crisis begins in Hue, that the first protests against the regime are in Hue. They were directly the result of actions taken by Ngo Dinh Thoc. The episode that John alluded to that takes place on May 8, 1963, ostensibly it's about religious flags, about the police in Hue and their attempt to suppress the Buddhists and the Buddhists wanted to display religious flags on Vesak Day, which is the holiest day of the Buddhist calendar. But it wasn't really about flags. It was really about Ngo Dinh Thoc. One of Diem's other brothers, his younger brother Ngo Dinh Gun, had actually had ordered the police to stand down and not to crack down on the Buddhists, and he was overruled by Thoc. So that initial incident in Hue is very much sparked by Ngo Dinh Thoc and by Buddhist anger with him. Diem's first reaction when the Buddhist movement begins is actually to try to settle it by negotiation. And this makes perfect sense given his prior relations with these Buddhist leaders. He knew who these guys were, at least some of them. He actually negotiated a deal in early June 1963 with Buddhist moderates, but the deal is then blown up by yet another of Diem's brothers, Ngo Dinh Nhu, who along with his wife, the infamous Madam Nhu, convinced Diem to take a hardline approach. So there's this very important shift in Diem's thinking over the course of the Buddhist crisis. And there are a couple of different actions here that are important. On the one hand, Madam Nhu comes out with an attack on the Buddhists, a verbal attack on the Buddhists at a key moment in early June. This leads then to the self-immolation of Thich Quang Duc. When Thich Quang Duc initially proposed to burn himself to Buddhist leaders, they turned him down. They said, no, we don't need this. We're negotiating with the government. This is going to be fine. But then after the news blow up the negotiated accord between the Buddhists and the government, then the Buddhist leaders turned back to Ngo Dinh, or they turned back to Thich Quang Duc. The decision to have Thich Quang Duc burn himself on June 11th, 1963, was made the night before, on June 10th. So what had happened was Thich Quang Duc had proposed this a couple weeks earlier. Buddhist leaders said, no, we don't need you to do this. But then they made that decision on June 10th, no, we do need you to do this. And one of the sources that I used was the memoir of one of the young Buddhist acolytes who was called into a meeting of the Buddhist leadership, and they said, we've decided that the Reverend Thich Quang Duc is going to burn himself to death tomorrow morning. You have to go find him right now and make sure he's still okay with this. The larger point here is that these conflicts within the Ngo family are very important. They intersect with this Buddhist reaction to Diem's nation-building programs in 1963, and they contribute directly, I argue, to his downfall. Okay, by way of wrapping up, My argument here is, again, about the centrality of ideas about nation building in the history of the Vietnam War and specifically in the history of the Diem regime. I don't think Diem was either a puppet or a creature of tradition, as he's often been represented. He had his own ideas, his own vision for nation building in South Vietnam. It was not a liberal vision, and ultimately it was not a successful vision, but he did have an agenda, and it's something that historians need to take seriously. In his efforts to pursue this vision, Diem was not entirely lacking in success, again, especially in the area of state building. But in the area of identity building, he was much less successful. And this is particularly apparent, I think, in episodes such as the Buddhist crisis of 1963. At the same time, Diem's nation building ideas also lead to friction with the United States. And in the fall of 63, these two problems, the reaction to his policies within South Vietnam and the friction with the United States, combined to bring about Diem's downfall. Thank you very much.
Thank you for a great presentation. I'm pleased to present Pierre Aslan, Assistant Professor of History at Hawaii Pacific University. His book is Hanoi's War to the Vietnam War, 1954-1965, and I believe it was published this year.
I want to thank the organizers for inviting me to participate. It's a real honor to be amongst you guys tonight, so thank you very much for that. Before I begin, just a quick disclaimer. I'm not French. I'm French-Canadian. I'm not here to vindicate Grandpa who died at Dien Bien Phu. I just watched Rambo one too many times as a kid, and I got into the whole Vietnam thing that way. So I have no personal connection to Vietnam. I'm going to talk to you tonight about the year 63 in North Vietnam, which 63 was a big year in the U.S. It was a huge year in South Vietnam. I maintain that in North Vietnam, it was a monumental year. This was a watershed moment in the history of the so-called Vietnamese Communist Revolution, and I'll try and shed some light on that with you tonight. The research, this is a product of research I've conducted in archives in Vietnam, also in archives in France, the UK, and Canada, because those were the only three Western countries allowed to keep a diplomatic mission in North Vietnam, in Hanoi, after 1954. The U.S. was there, but the Americans get kicked out in 55. The French are there because technically they're responsible for implementing the Geneva Accords, so they get to stay. The Brits are there because they were co-chairmen of the Geneva Conference. They get to stay. And the Canadians are there because they're just nice people. Now I'm just, the Canadians are there because they're part of this supervisory commission to help the different parties apply the Geneva Accords. And so their diplomats in Hanoi are reporting back to their home governments, and those archives are really, really valuable to get a sense of what's going on in Hanoi, because there's stuff in Vietnam. It's hard to get, but it's there. But the thing is, the Vietnamese aren't particularly forthcoming in terms of sharing their archives with foreign scholars, even with their own scholars. The history of the Vietnam War for Hanoi is basically the government's property, the party's property. And so it poses a variety of different challenges. Let me see if this. Okay, there we go. So as I'm sure you're all familiar with, in 1954, in mid-1954, the communist leadership enters into the Geneva Accords with France, which effectively put an end to the Indochina War. Now, we always talk about the French were forced to sign the accords because of Dien Bien Phu. Dien Bien Phu was just one battle in a long war. Yes, the Viet Minh, the communists, won that battle, but the war itself wasn't going all that great for them. And so when they enter into the Geneva Accords, it's for a variety of reasons. Number one, Ho Chi Minh and the communists are absolutely terrified of a U.S. intervention. By mid-54, they recognize the U.S. as the Vietnamese Revolution's number one enemy. And as far as they're concerned, if the war doesn't end, the Americans will intervene. So they signed the accords to preclude a U.S. intervention. Beyond that, they signed the accords because they think they're workable. They think that if they accept those accords, if the French abide by them, if they abide by them, within 2 years, the country is going to be reunified under communist governance. They're confident that those accords can actually work and essentially bring about what an 8-year war against France could not. The reunification of the country, again, under their governance, which is really their central goal. And after 54, and essentially 5 years or 6 years after that, basically the communist revolutionary strategy is what they call peaceful struggle. Political activity in the South, diplomatic initiatives internationally to increase the pressure on Saigon and Washington to respect the terms of the Geneva Accords. And even after 56, when the deadline to hold the elections passes with no progress on that front, the leadership in Hanoi continues to press for peaceful struggle, continues to hope that Vietnam can be reunified under their governance through a diplomatic arrangement, ideally the Geneva Accords, or else something similar to the 54 Accords. In 1959, Hanoi will authorize the onset of insurgent activity in South Vietnam. But it does that really against its own will. The leadership, Ho Chi Minh specifically, is concerned that if we instigate an insurgency, again, the Americans might use it as a pretext to become involved. But there's pressure from within the South, basically calling for Hanoi to authorize insurgent activity below the 17th parallel. And so in 59, an insurgency begins, but it's really a limited insurgency. And it's one which will not be very strongly supported by Hanoi. They'll send some guns, they'll send personnel, but most of these guys are not actual Northerners. They're Southerners who had regrouped to the North after 54, in accordance with the terms of the Geneva Accords, who were now being dispatched back to the South as volunteer troops, not as North Vietnamese Army regulars. Northerners are not involved in the insurgency that begins in 1959. Now, Ho's decision to enter into the Geneva Accords in 54, and then his decision to wage peaceful struggle afterwards did not sit well with everyone within the party, especially with combatants and cadres and leaders in the South. A number of these guys who stayed behind after the Geneva Accords or else who regrouped to the North were really disappointed that the leadership, that Ho and the communist leadership did not try to take advantage of the momentum created by Dien Bien Phu to really press the fight until complete victory against the French. And basically what happens by 1963 is that we have a split within the party. We have a party that's basically torn apart, split into two factions. Moderates, I guess doves we'd call them in this country on the one hand, and then militants or hawks on the other hand. And essentially, the moderates, they're the ones controlling communist decision making. They're led by Ho Chi Minh. And these guys basically want to maintain peace at all costs to preclude an American intervention. The militants, on the other hand, the hawks within the party, a number of whom had fought against the French in the South, or else were from the South originally, are basically seeing war as necessary to, quote-unquote, liberate the South and achieve national reunification. So we have this kind of impetuous faction, which since 54 has been pressuring Hanoi to be more proactive in the South, which starts gaining more and more momentum in the early 1960s. And we've talked about the Battle of Ab Bac earlier. The impact on the communist leadership is extremely significant. Basically, in 63, the militants become emboldened and they gain much wider support from within the party because of a series of events. The first one was the outcome of the Cuban Missile Crisis, which discredits Khrushchev and the whole idea of peaceful coexistence, the whole idea that you can basically negotiate with the West, with the United States. The year before, a set of accords on neutralizing Laos had been signed. By 63, those accords start falling apart, and the militants will use it as proof, again, that you can't negotiate with the Americans. Then there's the Battle of Ab Bac. They see as definitive proof that now is as good a time as ever to press the fight against the South, because that is weak, Diem is weak, the Americans are not yet interested in intervening in Vietnam, so we should strike now. Then there's what's going on in China. Early 60s, Chinese foreign policy becomes significantly more radical. Chinese domestic and foreign policy is basically undergoing a process of radicalization. That same year, 62, 63, for the first time, Beijing starts encouraging the Vietnamese to fight. Until then, despite their calls for violent national liberation in the Third World, the Chinese had no interest in another war in Vietnam. They did not want a repeat of what had happened in Korea. But by 62, 63 now, they favor war in Vietnam. And then there's the signing of the Partial Nuclear Test Ban Treaty in the summer of 63. And this will really alienate the Chinese because they see this as Soviet and American collusion to prevent China from having the bomb. And in that perception, the Chinese will be supported by the Vietnamese. Vietnamese militants in particular will see the Soviet decision to enter into the treaty with the Americans as basically a sellout of China and of the national liberation cause in the Third World. Here are the faces of the two camps. We're all familiar with Ho Chi Minh. Ho Chi Minh is the leader of the moderate camp. The other guy we don't know, but yet, as Robert and John have suggested, he's an extremely important individual. His name is Lê Duẩn, or Lê Duẩn. He will eventually take over party decision-making, and this is the guy who basically wages the war against the United States. Ho Chi Minh has nothing to do with policy-making after 65, during the war against the U.S. Vo Nguyen Giáp has been sidelined. We may have read the obituaries recently talking about the Tet Offensive as the product of Zap's military genius. Zap had nothing to do with the Tet Offensive. It was all Lê Duẩn's work. This is the guy, he becomes the Mao of Vietnam, the Stalin of Vietnam, the guy who basically will run things in Hanoi with an iron hand. November 63, as we've been discussing, as Jessica and Ed have mentioned, Ngo Dinh Diem is overthrown in the South, and this has huge significance for the North. Basically, it brings the conflict between militants and moderates to a head. And I claim that basically, within a few days after Diem is overthrown in Saigon, there's a coup of a different kind in the North, when militants basically seize the reins of power in Hanoi. They take over decision-making in Hanoi. So in November, December, basically, militants stage a coup of their own. They take over communist decision-making. They proceed to purge moderates, including Ho Chi Minh and Vo Nguyen Giáp. And then they endorse a really important resolution I'll be talking about tomorrow, Resolution 9, which calls for immediate, quote-unquote, decisive victory over enemy forces in South Vietnam. As early as January 64, we see a massive increase in the quantity and the quality of weapons that the North is sending to insurgents in the South. And then a few months later, in October, November, the first combat units of the North's armed forces, the People's Army of Vietnam or the NVA, are dispatched to go and fight against the Saigon regime. essentially the changes we see unfolding in Hanoi in 63, the militant coup against moderates, and specifically Resolution 9, will set North Vietnam on this irreversible collision course with the United States. Resolution 9 and its attendant full commitment of the North to the liberation of South Vietnam, in my opinion, marks the real beginning of the Vietnam War. When Johnson deploys the troops in 65, it's really to join a war that's already ongoing. The decision to start bombing the North and to dispatch the Marines is basically a reaction to initiatives undertaken by Hanoi. In 63-64, Vietnamese communist leaders start a major war they thought they could win before the U.S. entered the fight. They gambled and they lost. Thank you.
Okay, we have a lot of questions, I'm sure. So we will have more questions tomorrow, and we will have more time. Those who don't have the opportunity to ask a question, make a note and give us the piece of paper if you're not going to be here tomorrow, but I hope you all come. So let's go on with the first question.
Jessica Chapman reminded us that all politics are local. American politicians know this in this country, but the State Department doesn't seem to understand it in other countries. It's like they get a hold of facts, but they're simply to exploit differences, such as we send anthropologists to, you know, Afghanistan to find splits and exploitable things. And then the military is the one that's left to follow up on the policy. I'm wondering if any or all of you would care to comment on that, the failure to understand that the politics are local in other places.
Yes, thank you very much. That's one of the central arguments of my book, is that looking at the case of Vietnam and the ways in which American policymakers failed to apprehend the complexities of South Vietnamese domestic politics, not just during the moment in which the United States became interested in it, but in the sort of longer term in which its character became evident, was a major flaw in American foreign policy, and that looking at Vietnam as a Cold War battleground that could be defined and perceived in Cold War terms was the kind of fundamental problem. And I think, you know, Ed's work demonstrates in many ways that the United States became intimately familiar, I think, with certain Vietnamese politicians, and kind of because of the blinders that they put on, tended to put too much emphasis on those individuals and their outlooks, and kind of would, in some cases, and now I'm putting words in Ed's mouth, but I perceive that they read what was happening in Vietnam through the perception of figures like Diem, and that perception was flawed. You know, Diem would oftentimes sort of make comments about the domestic political sphere in which he operated, saying that it was so chaotic and people were so, you know, politically underdeveloped that certain policies which were perceived by his constituents as oppressive were actually necessary in his eyes. And so there was some kind of way in which Americans were getting their information about Vietnam through sources that they might have wanted to interrogate a little bit more closely than they did. And that, of course, happened with the earliest information they were getting about Vietnam, which was through the French, which they then kind of filtered through their own existing preconceptions. And there wasn't an intimacy with the entire range of what was happening in South Vietnam that would have maybe enabled them to perceive it differently and make different decisions about how to handle the situation.
Yeah. I guess in response to the question, following up on some things that Jessica said, I think you're right that actually over the course of the Vietnam War, the United States and certain Americans actually do acquire an extraordinary knowledge of Vietnamese politics. Certainly after the Americanization of the war in 1965, you have Americans who live out in the provinces, who often become very knowledgeable about particular areas and who really learn the politics backwards and forwards. And I think actually even in the earlier period that, that Jessica and I have written about, there are some diplomats who are in the embassy in Saigon, who were in the consulate in Hanoi prior to 1954, who really have their ear to the ground and who really pick up a lot. If you read the dispatches of somebody like Edmund Gullion, who was the chargé d'affaires in Saigon in the early 1950s, this guy is really paying attention to all of the different divisions among Vietnam's anti-communist groups. And this perhaps points to another area where Jessica and I are perhaps somewhat different. I think there are Americans in 1954 who are very skeptical of Diem. And I, the way I see the American view of Diem in 1954 is that there's a division. And in some cases, that the skepticism is based on some pretty serious knowledge of Vietnamese politics at the time. So, not in the case of Ambassador Douglas Dillon. I mean, he was in France. He didn't know anything about Vietnam. But there are other people in Vietnam, people like Paul Sturm, who had been the consul in Hanoi, who had very close ties to groups like Dai Viet. He was a big proponent of Phan Huy Quat, who was the leader of one of the factions of the Dai Viet. And this gets picked up by some other Americans, like Edward Lansdale, who's trying to pressure Diem to bring Quat into his cabinet, and Diem is resisting that. So this is not a case in which the United States doesn't know anything about Vietnamese politics and it just sort of backs Diem by default. It's much more complicated than that, and in some cases, Americans actually do know a lot about Vietnam. This is a case where we really have to take account of Diem's agency and Diem's ability in some cases to resist some of these American prescriptions. So I think it's not just a lack of information. In some cases, there is information there. It's what you do with it that I think really makes a big difference.
I'd like to say something. I have a bit of trouble with that question because of the nation state and national power. You know, yes, it's true, everything that Jessica and Ed are saying about how some, even in the State Department, understand the Vietnamese politics. And yes, it's also true, the premise of your question, that all politics is local, and why is it that the United States somehow never understands these things that are going on in other countries. But the place where this sort of goes fuzzy is that the function of the State Department is to implement American national policy and to gain national objectives that are set by the American government. So, in a sense, its function is specifically to go against local politics where they are and somehow turn them in America's favor, right? Now, having said that, the key rejoinder would then be, you know, well, did the State Department succeed in turning Vietnamese politics into the direction that the Americans wanted? And that's actually where we come back to Mr. Diem and 1963. Kennedy is frustrated that for everything we're doing for the Vietnamese, for all the money that we're giving them and the troops we're sending to Vietnam, we can't get Diem to do what we want him to do. So, yes, we did or did not understand their politics as local, and no, we were not successful in turning them in the direction we wanted.
In 1965, Margaret Higgins wrote a book called Our Vietnam Nightmare. So those of you who are familiar of it, with it, how does her history, her book, stand up to your research?
You want me to say it?
Go ahead. We can all take a turn on every question.
Yeah, Higgins is a very colorful figure, and her book is certainly an interesting and entertaining read. I think in some ways it's a good example of reportage. In her book, she relates some of the experiences she had. She was in Vietnam in 1963 during certain portions of the Buddhist crisis, and she actually interviewed Diem twice in August of 63. And those interviews are actually very important, I think, in understanding Zam's state of mind in the weeks leading up to the crackdown on the Buddhist crisis. I do think that Higgins' view of affairs was colored by her very sort of hardline anti-communist views, and especially by her sympathy for Zam. I mean, Zam can really do no wrong, which is why Zam granted her those interviews at that critical moment, because he knew that she could be counted on to write very sympathetically around it, about him. The other thing that's very memorable about Marguerite Higgins, I mean, the book is in some ways almost a memoir. And she was back in Washington in November when the coup took place. And according to her, I don't know if Roger Hilsman ever confirmed the story, but Hilsman, of course, was a State Department official, one of the State Department officials who did push very hard for the coup. And afterwards, many people in Vietnam and the United States sort of blamed Hilsman for the coup. And according to Higgins, she called Hilsman up at 3 o'clock in the morning, like the next day after the coup or something, and she said, "How does it feel to have blood on your hands, Roger?" And Roger said, "Oh, Maggie, you know, this is a revolution. People get hurt. Go back to bed." Or at least that's the way she relayed it. I don't know if Hilsman ever told his side of the story or not.
I wonder, especially for the two are talking about ZM. Either of you had a chance to read the new book on Madame Nu, and if that's changed any of your viewpoints on ZM. Because it has, I think, an unpublished memoir that they've kind of finally put out.
It's out in France, and I'm on my way to get a copy tomorrow.
Yeah, I have not seen the previously unpublished, well, there's actually two texts authored by Madame Nu. There's a memoir, and then there's also a diary. And the memoir, I'm pretty sure, is legitimate, because I never met Madame Nu while she was alive, but there were a number of people I spoke to, including Monique Bryson Demery, who's the author of the recent book. And I think that Demery got the memoir from Madame Nu. The diary has a much more unclear provenance, and it supposedly surfaced in Vietnam in the 60s, and then but the chain of custody is a little bit hard to pin down. So there's some uncertainty there. I saw portions of the book in draft form. I have to confess I haven't seen the published version yet. I think that from what I've seen from Demery's work, she's to be commended for taking Madame Nu seriously, because if Zam has been caricatured, as I suggested, Madame Nu has been even more caricatured. I think there are some important questions about Madame Nu that at least from what I've seen of Demery's work, she leaves unanswered. Things like her feminism. Madame Nu considered herself a feminist, and even though her feminism is not what most Americans would recognize as feminism, that was still a very integral part of her and her political program. So I think there's still a lot more interesting research that could be done on Madame Nu.
Well, first of all, with a comment of Margaret Higgins, you guys will recall that Margaret Higgins attacked the Saigon Press Corps in 62, 63. She called Malcolm Brown and Halberstam and all those guys unpatriotic because of their reportage. And Madame Nu, of course, when she made her famous comment about the immolation of the Buddhist monks, she actually provoked the first anti-war demonstrations on her tour in the United States. There were demonstrations at Columbia. A friend of mine's mother was involved in that demonstration. Now, I wanted to ask a question about the period from 54 to 59. This is a very controversial period in Vietnam. And I want to ask the question about what your understanding is now of what the Viet Minh, the stay-behinds, were doing, what was going on the ground. There's always controversy about this when the new Arvin military, which was a French colonial force in the main, transformed into the Army of the Republic of Vietnam, which still hasn't been really clarified, and even Bob Brigham's book doesn't really clarify that. What happened in the ground, from your understanding with new work, from 54 to 59 with the Vietnamese communist stay-behinds in all the different areas of the country? Some argue that land reform was thrown back in certain areas. Some people argue landlords made people pay back rent. So what do you guys understand from your knowledge, because a lot of us are pretty well informed about this out here too, what happened?
Okay, can I? All right, so the orders coming from Hanoi are very, very, or from the leadership are very, very clear. Communist combatants have to regroup to the north. They have to stand down, they can't fight, they have to regroup to the north. Some communist cadres can stay in the south, and they actually order close to 10,000 cadres to stay in the south. But those are political cadres, which under the terms of the Geneva Accords can stay in the south, but the combatants have to go to the north. Now, based on stuff I found in the French archives, it looks like a significant number of southern combatants decided not to go to the north, basically acted against, contravened the orders they were given by their superiors. 54 through 59, Hanoi is very clear, we are not to resume armed struggle, as I suggested and as I pointed out in my presentation. But what will happen is that a number of Viet Minh will then start joining other organizations which they see are doing more to actually take action against Diem, including the sects that Jessica talked about. A number of Viet Minh will basically break rank. They'll join other organizations, or else they'll start taking independent action. And those were a huge liability for Hanoi. Hanoi was very concerned about those guys. In 59, there's a bunch of uprisings that take place. And the understanding was that those uprisings take place in the south because Hanoi has finally given those guys authorization. And now what we're realizing is that in a number of places in the south, those uprisings are taking place actually days, if not weeks, before the authorization to take action comes from Hanoi. So Hanoi is having a hard time controlling the Viet Minh elements who stay in the south after 54. But as far as the directives are concerned, they're very, very clear. Viet Minh communist combatants are to take no action that would basically break the letter or the spirit of the Geneva Accords.
I would just add to that as far as what's going on the ground. Certainly, there is some rollback in those areas that had been controlled by the Viet Minh, where the Viet Minh had carried out some redistribution of land. There is some rollback of that. Diem passes a rent reduction law in early 1955, or he issues a rent reduction decree, which has the effect of allowing some landowners to go back and claim land that they had previously that had previously been redistributed by the Viet Minh. However, the situation there is a little bit more complicated than the way it's often been represented. Some scholars have looked at Diem's measures. They've also looked at his unwillingness to go very far with his own land reform program and said, look, Diem wasn't interested in agrarian reform. He basically favored the rural status quo in South Vietnam, a return to the pre-war status quo. And I argue against that. I think that Diem actually just had a different vision of agrarian transformation. And whereas the Americans were calling for thoroughgoing land reform, for redistributing the land, Diem's approach to agrarian reform emphasized redistributing the people. This is why he was so into resettlement and into moving people around and especially moving people from crowded areas or areas he saw as crowded in South Vietnam into other parts of the country that were lightly populated or unpopulated. So there's quite a lot that's going on the ground in various aspects of the country. As far as the cadres, after about 1956, the overwhelmingly dominant feature that they have to contend with is Diem's crackdown, which is really, really effective in 1957 and 1958. And the communist sources on this are quite clear, especially the stuff that's been published since 1975. In many districts of the South, Zem's security forces succeed in rolling up 90% or more of the cadres. And in some cases, the party apparatus has effectively ceased to function.
And they can't fight back, basically. Hanoi is telling them, in spite of all that's going on, you guys can't fight back. And that's when, in 59, Hanoi says, okay, now you can fight back,
right,
but only to protect yourselves from Diem, not to actually work to overthrow him.
Right. And I think there is this sense that a lot of the southern cadres are saying, look, we're getting killed.
Yeah.
We have no choice. And I think you're right. I think David Elliott has shown that there are very clear cases of these uprisings taking place before the news of Resolution 15 has been transferred to the south. So there's quite a lot that's going on in the south, in the rural areas at this time.
The only other thing I would add to that is that not all of the activity that was attributed to Viet Cong had anything to do with these communist cadres, just building on Pierre's point, that it was the way that Diem defined Viet Cong to be anybody who opposed the government, whether they be communists or non-communists, that sort of led to that conflation of all anti-government activity as being Viet Cong. And I think, in fact, framed all of that opposition in a way that actually encouraged it to unify against him.
And you make that point in your book. After 54, the main opposition to Diem in the South is not the communists. It's the religious sects. The communists are not a threat at all to Diem relative to the sects.
Excellent presentations. My question is regarding the military coup in South Vietnam. Someone mentioned that there was some division of opinions within the Kennedy administration, and I'm just wondering what was the actual position of the President Kennedy and the Vice President Johnson on this coup? Were they in support of all?
John, do you want to take that?
Vice President Johnson was certainly against a coup, no question. Johnson had visited Nguyen Dinh Diem in the spring of 1961 on a tour of Asia, had considered Diem his friend, and was a stalwart supporter of Diem through thick and thin, right until the day of the coup when Diem was killed. John Kennedy is a more complex character. I was thinking about that earlier today, as a matter of fact. You know, if you look at Kennedy's actions in the major foreign policy crises of his presidency, Cuban Missile Crisis, of course, comes right up, the Berlin Wall Crisis, the Bay of Pigs, and now what happens in Vietnam in 1963, okay? I think what you would encounter is a gentleman who always had a clear idea of where he was going. It's true that in the Cuban crisis, Kennedy stood back and let his chief advisors sort of debate amongst each other, amongst themselves, what direction that they should go in. But in all the other cases, what Kennedy did was basically to go around the table and say to each one, okay, are you good with this? Whatever it was that they were considering doing. And when this question of the coup in South Vietnam comes up, I believe that's essentially what Kennedy does. Now, some of my colleagues may disagree with this, and we can have this debate. But I think that the evidence is there that Kennedy took a certain position in favor of sort of forcing Saigon to move ahead in the direction the United States wanted, no matter whether that meant getting rid of Nguyen Dinh Diem. Fundamentally, they wanted to get rid of the people around Diem, the Nguo family. But if Diem would not agree to that, and it was a fair bet that Diem would not agree to that, then Diem had to go. Now, there exists a tape. Kennedy had a taping system, you know. And he could choose what meetings in the Oval Office, flick a button, and tape them. And the tape is Kennedy's meeting with Henry Cabot Lodge, whom he was appointing to be... Are we okay? Whom he was appointing to become ambassador to Saigon. This is in the middle of August of 1963. This is before anyone is talking about a coup, and before any of this other stuff has ever happened. And Kennedy tells Lodge that one of his big jobs in Saigon is going to be to deal with the problem of Diem, and that that may require a coup. And if it does require a coup, Lodge is going to be in charge of making it work, essentially. So I think Kennedy already had that idea in his head early.
I haven't heard that particular tape. That's very interesting. Is that recently declassified?
Not recent, but it's not well known.
Okay. That's very interesting. I certainly look forward to hearing that. The way I look at Kennedy and his whole approach to Vietnam in 1963, and actually earlier as well, I think that Kennedy's fundamental impulse in Vietnam was to try to keep his options open. Maximum room for maneuver with everything. The moment at which Kennedy crosses the line and endorses regime change comes with the August 24th cable that Bob mentioned at the outset of the proceedings this evening. And that cable is very controversial, the way it's drafted by Hilsman and Forrestal and the way it's transmitted to Saigon. And it becomes a big subject of debate both at the time and afterwards. But Kennedy does not recall it. Kennedy does not change it. But that doesn't mean that he sort of switched over and he said, well, we're definitely going to have a coup now. What it means is that the coup option is on the proverbial table. And I think this is relevant to understanding not just the issue of the coup, but also, of course, the very contentious issue of the Kennedy withdrawal. I don't think Kennedy had made a definite decision about what to do with Vietnam. I think withdrawal was one possibility. I think going in bigger was one possibility for him in 1963.
In the year 1963, I was 14 or 15 years old. But one thing I remember was the name of Cardinal Spellman came up a lot in the United States. And I'm just wondering, and he was very close to the Kennedys, as well as the Diem government, the people in Diem and the Nose. And I'm wondering what kind of influence he did have at that time. Thank you.
Go ahead, John.
Oh, sorry. Are we okay here? I think that Cardinal Spellman had considerable influence on the American press, on the sort of public presentation of Vietnam as an issue in the United States. I think that in the late 1950s and going into the 60s, he had a more direct political influence inside the American government. But that, I believe, diminished in part because Kennedy himself understood that he needed to bend over backwards in order to not appear to be responding to Catholics and Roman Catholicism as a political influence on him. That was a major issue in the 1960 election. Kennedy was facing a re-electoral campaign in 1964.
Just to add to that, I think I mostly agree with that. The issue of Spellman's influence is most often invoked in connection with Diem with his appointment in 1954. And I think this is another issue on which Jessica and I will have to agree to disagree. Spellman was very close to the Ngo brothers. The connection was through Ngo Dinh Thoc, the older brother who became the archbishop. They had studied in Rome together in the 1920s. So they went way back. And
the Catholic networks that Spellman has access to, the international Catholic networks, are very important for Ziem, especially when he's in exile in the United States and Europe in the early 1950s. There's no evidence, though, that Spellman played any role in securing Ziem's appointment in 1954, as has often been alleged. There's just none. There's no reliable evidence of this. It's been long asserted, going back to this poorly sourced article that was published by Robert Scheer and Warren Hinkle in the 1960s. But no one has ever come forward. There's no evidence to support this. Spellman did have a lot of connections with people in Congress. A lot of these people in Congress, especially Catholic members of Congress, people like Kennedy. Kennedy met Ziem in 1953 when he was in the U.S. They really liked Ziem a lot. But if you look at Ziem's interactions with executive branch officials, with officials first in the Truman administration and then in the Eisenhower administration, Ziem bombs every single time. So there's really no evidence that Ziem, during this period of his exile in the United States, is making these connections in the executive branch, which will then translate into some kind of U.S. pressure campaign on behalf of his appointment in 1954. There's just no evidence to support that I've seen, and no one's been able to produce it. I've been saying this for a long time. Historians continue to assert it, but no one comes forward with the evidence.
Thank you. Imagine if our founders had been foolish enough to believe that all politics is local. This question is directed to John. Your colleagues seem to want to blame the Vietnamese for the conflict. It was never a war. McMaster wrote a book about the dereliction of duty by the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Can you say something about the dereliction of duty by the State Department and CIA, specifically in terms of a particular family that was controlling both and their sister?
Repeat that last part.
The Dulles brothers, one in charge of the State Department, the other in charge of the CIA, and their sister, the dereliction of duty by the CIA and the State Department in terms of the conflict caused in 1963, as opposed to blaming it on the Vietnamese.
Okay, so we're going back to the 1950s here. We're talking about the Eisenhower administration, during which time Alan Dulles is the chief of the CIA, and his brother, John Foster Dulles, is the Secretary of State, and their sister is an Assistant Secretary of State. So this is certainly a case of, I don't know, the family that does something together does something together. Dulles, the two Dulles brothers, absent Eleanor at this point, going back to 1955 and the sects and the Battle of Saigon, there is to this day an existing mystery about what happened during those days. Ngo Dinh Diem was on the brink of either great success or crashing in flames in his contest with the political religious sects in Saigon in 1955. And Ed Lansdale, who was a subordinate CIA officer, was agitating for the CIA to take an active role in support of Ziem. And the Dulles brothers were in catbird position in Washington, D.C., with President Dwight Eisenhower deciding what to do in this crisis in Saigon, during which his personal friend, an Army general named J. Lawton Collins, whom he had appointed as ambassador to Saigon as well as his presidential representative in South Vietnam, was recommending that the United States remove support from Ziem because he had concluded that Ziem was not going to make the reforms that needed to be made and that his power could not endure. Well, a moment comes where Eisenhower, in fact, is convinced by Collins and induces John Foster Dulles to go along with issuing the order to remove support from Diem, with all that that entailed for the United States. And suddenly that State Department directive is countermanded within a matter of about less than 2 days. And during that interval, there is an exchange of communications between Lansdale and Allen Dulles, and there's a private meeting between Allen and John Foster. So that is at least one explicit instance where something along the lines of what you're talking about actually did happen in U.S. policy.
I would just add to that account, I agree with John's chronology here. But the thing that happens in the interim is the start of the Battle of Saigon.
Oh, yeah.
And it is prior to the Battle of Saigon, a lot of people think that this thing could go either way. But in retrospect, I think the evidence shows pretty clearly that Diem had the upper hand, and that Diem actually had been looking for several weeks for an excuse to start the battle, because he knew that his support within the Vietnam National Army, which becomes the ARVN, has been shored up. He and his brothers had done their work very well in recruiting the forces. And in the end, the resistance that comes from the Binh Xuyen and the Cao Dai and the Hoa Hao, when push comes to shove, they really don't acquit themselves very well at all. The Vietnam National Army gets the upper hand in about 2 days in the Battle of Saigon. And in the subsequent campaigns against Cao Dai and Hoa Hao forces in the Delta, Diem is able to execute this divide and conquer strategy. So yes, there are these communications that are going, these back-channel communications between people like Lansdale and Dulles. But we should not conclude from that those are the most important things, and that everything that happens in South Vietnam in 1954 and 55 turns on the actions of Edward Lansdale. I would just finish up by saying, in response to the question, the way I see the Vietnam War is there's plenty of blame to go around. So I do not, by suggesting that Vietnamese actors have some agency and some responsibility here, I do not mean to suggest that American actors do not also have agency and responsibility. They certainly do.
Okay, I want to say more. Can we get the microphone over this way, because we might do some little dialogue here? Remind me now, this chronology. If I'm not mistaken, Battle of Saigon breaks out around 28th, 26th, 27th, 28th of March, 55? 28th?
Of April.
Right. No, there are two. There are two successive stages of it.
Well, the first one's
in March, one's in April.
End of March, yeah.
End of March, right.
And, okay. And Diem thought that was it. Diem felt that his troops were in position, and the French were being actually blocked.
Okay, and Collins makes a trip back to Washington.
That comes in April.
Right? That's in April, right before the second stage of the battle. Okay. So there's a first stage of the battle, and it's on edge in Saigon. Collins goes back to Washington. I believe that this meeting between the two Dulles brothers is on the 17th of April. The records of it, by the way, are still classified. I've been trying to get them opened for years, but that's another issue. And then Collins succeeds in getting this order issued. He gets on a plane to go back to Saigon just before the second stage of that battle breaks out, and his plane is detained in Hawaii for nearly 2 days. And while Collins is stuck in Hawaii and unable to execute this order, the battle starts.
I think he was still in Saigon, or still in Washington.
He was still in Washington
when the battle starts.
On the 28th.
Yeah. The time period between the issuing of the cable that, you know, telling the embassy to contact the French and look for alternative leadership, and its recall is actually shorter than 2 days. It's about 6 hours, as I remember.
Yes, that's right.
And
that's right.
And So that comes out.
But Collins is unable to dispute it, is the point.
Right, but he's still in Washington at that time. So, I mean, he may be delayed going back to Saigon afterwards, but the critical decisions and the critical developments of Saigon take place while he's still in Washington. I'm quite sure about that.
Gentlemen, lady and gentlemen, two questions, one very short and one a little bit longer. The short question, did the folks who were being taped by John F. Kennedy, did they know they were being taped? I'm wondering. But the second question is, frankly, how do you know, how many people in South Vietnam in 1963 really wanted to be ruled by a communist dictatorship? I mean, we know in retrospect that the rule of Le Duan was horrific. When he died in 86, it was a great day for the Vietnamese people. But even in 1963, they had the example of North Korea and China, which already had gone through collectivization, two horrific events. What was the real popularity of the notion of communist dictatorship rule in South Vietnam?
Kennedy tape question, and Pierre can take the other. Robert McNamara once said that if you sat around the cabinet table and you looked at the way that the president looked at you during the meetings, you had to assume you were being taped.
The only people who really understood Marxism-Leninism in Vietnam were the core leaders in Hanoi. The guys in the South, even high-ranking cadres in the South, didn't really understand what the whole thing was about. And as it turns out, the directives were coming from the party, basically telling subordinates to always present the Vietnamese revolution as a nationalist revolution. So the idea was that, you know, we were going to be fight as one, and once it was over, then we would have the second revolution, the socialist revolution, where we would proceed to implement this, you know, the society that Marxism or Marxism-Leninism dictated would go on. So the movement is popular in the South because it presents itself as an anti-American, anti-Diem, pro-Vietnamese movement. And it's in the South anyway. It's not until after 75 that people then get to see really what the objective was, again, for the core leaders in Hanoi. And that's why that story is important, is that when we look at why people were fighting in Vietnam on the communist side, the reasons that are motivating the leadership in Hanoi are very, very different from what's motivating the guys doing the fighting in the South, which I guess is no different from the American experience in that war. To say that, you know, those were communists, we got to use the term very, very loosely. The real communists were in Hanoi. Le Duan, I maintain in the book, was extremely dogmatic, really, really ideological, and approached the war as a necessity, not just to liberate Vietnam, but basically to defeat imperialism around the world. These are guys who believe in this idea of world revolution, and in serving as a model for national liberation, just like Castro, after his revolution, starts investing a lot in promoting national liberation in Africa and elsewhere, the Vietnamese have the same designs, the leadership has the same designs, in terms of making the Vietnamese revolution an example for those fighting against the U.S., against imperialism, and against reactionary forces everywhere.
We have to stop here. Please hold your questions for tomorrow, and thank you for coming.